Tom Gates, Top of the Class, Nearly, by Liz Pidgeon. School council elections. Vote for me! Do you want to become a school councillor? Well, now's your chance. Yeah! The school council makes a lot of important decisions about what goes on in Oakford School. Design a poster that tells your classmates why they should vote for you. Good luck, everyone. The countdown begins now. This is a big moment for me. I've been voted on the school council and I'm about to make a speech in front of the whole school. Amy is clapping and everyone is cheering. Hooray! Getting ready for my speech. Everyone, that is, apart from Marcus Meldrew, who's just sitting there looking all grumpy. I clear my throat, stand up and avoid eye-to-eye contact with Marcus. Here goes applause. Hello, everyone. Firstly, can I say a huge thank you for voting for me? More applause. From the way Marcus is shifting around in his seat and being all awkward, I'm guessing that he didn't vote for me. As one of your new school councillors, I promise to do my very best for all of you. Then I hold up my Vote For Me poster. Let's make this list really happen. More cheers, but not from Marcus, who's fed up that he's not on the school council. School councillor, vote for Tom Gates. What will I do if you vote for me? Monday will be fun day, not the day everyone dreads. Tuesday is you Tuesday. Wear what you like to school. Wednesday means it's pens day, drawing and doodling in every class for extra merits. Thursday is now Thursday, bring your pet to school day. Friday will be surprise day, such as extra puddings or much bigger portions at lunchtime. I'm about to finish my speech when Mr. Fullerman interrupts me. Tom, sorry to stop you, but I have more good news that I'd like to share with the class. More good news, sir. How is that even possible? I'm joking, of course, because I can think of loads of other things that would be good news, like much shorter school days. Good news! Dog Zombies becoming the biggest band in the world apart from D3. Good news! Getting a pet. Really good news! I could go on, but Mr. Fullerman is waiting. Not only have you been voted on to the school council, but you've also achieved the highest score ever on last week's test. So congratulations to you, Tom, and very well done. More cheering and applause. Wow, that's amazing, sir. I wasn't expecting that. Tests aren't my strong point, but I did work extra hard, so I'm pleased about getting a top mark. As I'm waiting for the kids to stop clapping, I remember something else I want to say. Before I finish, I'd like to thank Amy Porter, who lent me her lucky pen. More clapping. Amy laughs and shrugs her shoulders like it was nothing. Marcus looks even more fed up now. I still ignore him. Norman Watson and Derek Fingal, both of you stand up. Derek stands, Norman leaps into the air while bowing and smiling at everyone. Now, I'm a school counsellor. I'll be helping with this year's school concert. And Norman and Derek had the idea to contact a very special band. So it's thanks to them that I've got this. I take out a letter and hold it up to show the kids. Can you see it? Shall I read it? Yes, they shout. Apart from Marcus, who's got his arms folded. Yo, Oakfield, school dudes. We heard you have awesome school concerts. I stop reading and say, they've obviously never been to one of our school concerts. Which makes everyone laugh. Well, not everyone. Marcus. We got your fantastic letter and we've decided to come and play at your concert with the one and only Dog Zombies supporting us. See you there, little dudes. There are lots of amazed faces. That's right, D3 are coming to play at our school concert. How good is that? I have to stop speaking because the whole school has gone completely crazy. Even Marcus is cheering now. Norman is leaping around shouting, yes, yes, and D3. I'm waiting for the noise to die down and thinking about how everything has worked out so brilliantly. Being voted onto the school council, Dog Zombies supporting D3, and I'm top of the class in the school test. Sigh. Everything is going so well when there's suddenly a really loud noise next to my head, which gives me a big shock. Huh? Thud. I'm sorry, Tom. Did I wake you? It's Mr. Fullerman. No, sir, I say quickly, opening my eyes. I was having the best daydream ever, and he's gone and spoilt it. I'm blinking and trying to think of something to say that will get me out of trouble. I wasn't asleep, sir. I was concentrating really hard. Were your eyes closed, Tom? Mr. Fullerman wonders. Yes, sir. I have special eyelids that are sort of see-through. It might look like I was asleep, but I can still tell what's going on, even with my eyes closed. My dad says that when I change the TV channel while he's asleep, zzz, click. Hey, I was watching that. Let me get this right, Tom. You're telling me you have see-through eyelids, Mr. Fullerman says, while raising an eyebrow. Yes, sir. Other people in my family have them too. That's remarkable. Scientists should be lining up to study your amazing eyelids. They should be, I nod. But just for now, could you at least try and keep your see-through eyelids open and your head off the desk? That way, I'll be able to tell that you're really paying attention in this catch-up class. Is that okay with you, Tom? Yes, sir, I say. I'm not sure Mr. Fullerman is convinced. After he's gone, Brad Galloway leans forward and whispers, Show me your see-through eyelids then. That's freaky. Later, Brad. This could take some explaining. Somehow, I've ended up in catch-up class. Being here is supposed to help me get better marks in my school test. It's not like I didn't know the answers to the questions. I just wasn't really concentrating as much as I probably should have been. The first time Mr. Fullerman mentioned the test, he said, on his very serious face, Tests are nothing to be nervous about. You just have to work hard and concentrate, but please don't worry about this very important test. But the way he kept saying very important test made some kids worry about it a lot. Not me, though. Me not being worried. The school sent a letter home about the test that looked quite serious as well. When Mum and Dad read it, Mum told me, Just try your best, Tom. It's not the end of the world if you don't do that well. As far as we're concerned, it's the effort that really counts. So don't worry about the test, Dad said. I'm not worried, I said. Which was true. I wasn't worried at all. Then Delia turned up and joined in. So let me get this straight. When Tom comes at the bottom of the class in the test, you won't mind, she said, trying to make a point. Tom won't be at the bottom of the class, will you, Tom? Dad said, looking at me. He might be. You're not the greatest at tests, are you, Tom? If Tom is at the bottom of the class in this test, and it's a big if, as long as he tried his best, we won't mind at all. I couldn't get a word in edgeways with everyone discussing how badly I was going to do in my test. Eventually, I managed to say, Excuse me, I might do really well in the test and come top of the class. Silence. No one said anything. Finally, Mum spoke and said, Yes, of course, you might be, Tom. Which made Delia laugh even more. Then she said, Ha, and guess what? Tom might get a pet unicorn too. But that's not going to happen, is it? What does that mean? I wanted to know. If you can't say something nice, Delia, just keep quiet, Mum told her sternly. You'll do fine, Tom. Don't worry about a thing, Dad tells me again. I could hear Delia still laughing as she went upstairs. Ha 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 ha. Mum and Dad wouldn't stop talking about this test, even after Delia had left. I'm sure you'll be absolutely fine, as long as you concentrate, Mum said. You do tend to get a bit distracted, Dad added. Then, as they were chatting, I suddenly thought of a very important question. Can I ask you something? Ask away, Tom, Mum and Dad both said patiently. What I really want to know is, yes, unicorns don't actually exist, do they? No, they don't, Tom. Sigh. I thought so. Just checking. Mind you, if unicorns did exist, how good would that be? Here are some made-up pets I drew. Giant monster pet. Walkies. Mini monster pet. Good for pockets. As tall as a caramel wafer. Unicorn. To whom? Marcus not believing his eyes. It's not like I deliberately messed up my test. Things just didn't quite work out for the way I thought they were going to. For a start, if Derek hadn't reminded me about the test on the way to school, I'd have forgotten all about it. It was written on the calendar, but Mum and Dad have extra busy with work, so no one reminded me it was today. It's a mock test, not the real one, Derek said, as we kept walking. We have to do two tests, I asked. Yep. Oh, great. You haven't forgotten our sleepover, too, Derek checked with me. As if. We have plans to write some dog zombie tunes with Norman, so I was looking forward to that. Here's what I did before the test, which didn't help much. Mr. Fullerman told us we'd start the test after our break, and we could read it until then, which I did for a bit until I got an idea for a drawing, but I still kept thinking about the test. Test. I think about it at break time as well. Test. It took Norman to say, "He wants to try on my glasses," for me to stop thinking about it for a while. Derek looked like a newsreader when he put them on. Sola's big head made the glasses look a lot smaller, and they made my eyes go all fuzzy. "Where are you all?" "Here." What I saw looking at Derek. "What would you do if you lost your glasses?" I asked Norman as I handed them back. "Bump into things, or in this case, solid." When break was over and we went back to class, Mr. Fullerman had already put the test papers onto our desks. "Oh, here we go," I whispered. Groan. Here's what happened during the test. The first thing that happened when Marcus said I had weird marks on my face. They're on your nose too. I tried on Norman's glasses. "Maybe it's that. Maybe my eyes are still fuzzy," I tried to explain. "That was stupid then," Marcus said, which I couldn't really argue with. Mr. Fullerman gave us some instructions. "Don't turn over the paper until I tell you. Then write your name and your class at the top, please." He asked us a few other things about pens, paper, and that kind of thing. Did we have everything we needed for the test? "I needed the answers," I whispered to Amy, who sighed. Mr. Fullerman told us, "Concentrate, everyone." So that's what I did. I concentrated. Just not on the test. I wrote my name carefully and answered the first question. All good so far. But after the second question, my pen suddenly stopped working, which was annoying. I turned my paper over and scribbled really hard to try and get the pen working again. Then I tried shaking the pen when Mr. Fullerman wasn't looking. I could have asked him for a new one, but he'd made a really big point of saying, "Does everyone have a pen that works? Please check now, because I don't want to be handing out pens once you've started." I said, "Yes, sir," because my pen was working then. I looked round to see if anyone else had a spare pen. Marcus wouldn't lend me a pen, even if he did have one. I glanced over to Amy's desk, and she had a pen, smiley face. So I tried to attract her attention by scribbling some more to prove that my pen had run out. "It stopped working," I whispered, just as the pen started to work. Amy sighed and carried on with her test. I answered the next question, then my pen stopped writing again. This time, I waved it around, which made ink blobs come out. My test paper was starting to look a bit messy. All my frantic scribbling and pen shaking was starting to annoy Amy. She finally pushed her spare pen in my direction. "Here, take it," she said. I drew a smiley face to say thank you. Now I had a pen that worked. I could start answering the rest of the questions. There was ink on my hand as well, which made a few splodges on the paper. So I wrote, "Look at its face. This was an accident. Sorry." I was about to get back to the test when my foot began to itch, like it was on fire. Maybe there was something inside my sock biting me. I couldn't concentrate. I tried really hard to ignore my itchy foot, but that didn't work. All I could think about was my itchy foot, itchy foot, itchy foot. Why is my foot so itchy? Ah! I tried leaning to one side and scratching my foot with my hand, but I couldn't quite reach it, so I grabbed my pen and tried to push it inside my sock. Then I decided the only thing to do was to take off my shoe and sock and have a proper scratch. After a few blissful moments of scratching, it felt so much better that I sighed quite loudly, sigh. And when I looked up, Amy was watching me. She shook her head and carried on doing the test. I forgot I was using her pen to scratch with. All the pen shaking and foot scratching had taken up a lot more test time than I thought. As I was trying to put my sock on, Marcus Meldry started doing, "Your foot smells," signs at me. Then Mr. Fullerman told Marcus to get on with the test. I managed to slip my sock into my pocket, so Mr. Fullerman didn't spot what I'd been doing. When I finally got back to the test, some of the questions were really quite hard, glancing over in Amy's direction didn't help much, as she was already on a different page. Then Mr. Fullerman suddenly announced, "You have 10 minutes to check your answers carefully." Check them? I hadn't even started most of them. I try not to worry, because when I'm in maths, 10 minutes goes really slowly. I thought I had ages, but these 10 minutes whizzed past, and before I could get to the end of the paper, Mr. Fullerman was already saying, "Okay, everyone, put down your pens and turn your paper over." "Now," I said. "Yes, Tom." I turned over my paper, which was covered in my scribbles, drawings, and ink blobs. It was a doodle test. I'd be right at the top of the class. "The test was easy, wasn't it?" Marcus said to me afterwards. "Sort of," I said. Then Marcus kept bragging, "It's the easiest test I've ever done in my whole entire life. It was so easy that even your stinky feet didn't put me off," he told me while doing wafty hand signs at me again. I had an itchy foot, which reminded me that I still had Amy's pen. I tried to give it back to her, but she said, "Keep it. You might need to scratch your other foot as well." As we left the classroom, Amy was still saying stuff like, "I'll probably get top marks." I didn't say anything because I had a sneaky feeling that I hadn't done quite so well in the test. What happened after the test? Mum and Dad had been pretty relaxed about my test right up until I got the letter home saying it might be useful for me to go to the special catch-up classes. They started asking questions about how I was doing in school, and they wrote a note to Mr. Fullerman in my school planner. Normally, I don't bother them with my planner, especially as they've been so busy with work. It's easier to write my own comments. "Tom is very good boy all the time," parents comments. "Mr. Fullerman, how is Tom doing in class? Should we be worried about his progress? Is there anything more we could do to help him?" I really wanted to write next to that comment, "Yes, no chores for Tom, ever. That would help him a lot." I didn't, which was hard. Mum and Dad were even talking about coming to see Mr. Fullerman about me. I told them there were loads of other kids doing catch-up classes, so they didn't have to worry. I'm not the only one, honestly. In the end, they decided to wait until parents' evening, which Mum said was coming up soon. Phew. I was glad about that because my parents can be embarrassing when they come near my school. "Tom, here, dinosaur suit. Group hug, family hug." I was looking forward to Derek's sleepover even more now. But when I reminded Mum about it, she told me, "The sleepover will have to wait. Sorry, Tom." "Why?" I wanted to know. "Because Derek has catch-up class as well, so no sleepovers until the test is over, okay?" Mum was doing her "don't argue with me" voice. I wasn't going to change her mind. I was really fed up, and I knew Derek would be too. I went up to my room, where I could see Derek from my window. He was busy writing a message. We do that sometimes. He held up the sign and didn't look very happy either, so I wrote him another message to try and make him laugh. "Catch up class, boo, sleepover cancelled. Let's go to this class instead. Catch up class. Chips, squirty sauce." Derek laughs. "Ha ha." I was hoping that catch-up class might even be fun. Well, if not fun, not as bad as it could be. The catch-up class. The catch-up classes were being held after school in the library and in our classroom too. Mr. Fullerman said anyone can come along if they want a bit of extra help with their test. But if you have a letter, I'll see you here. That was me then. "But put your hand up if you'd like to come along to catch-up class." No one put up their hand until Mr. Fullerman mentioned there would be drinks and snacks before the class to keep us all going. More kids were keen then. "You can't just come for the drinks and snacks," he added. Not so keen then. The rest of the day, I had to listen to Marcus telling me how well he'd done in his test. "Did I tell you how well I'd done in my test?" "You did. Lots of times," I yawned. The end of the school day couldn't come fast enough. At least there would be drinks and snacks to look forward to at the catch-up class. That was something. Help yourselves. Cakes, sweets, crisps, caramel, wafers. When the bell went for the end of school, most of my class got up to leave, and Mr. Fullerman finally brought out the snacks. Yeah, help yourself to plain biscuits and water, he said. Oh, if Mr. Fullerman wants to get more kids to stay for catch-up class, he'd better up the snack level, which wouldn't be hard. I still ate one, though. It was better than nothing. While Mr. Fullerman began explaining what we'd all be doing, I started to feel a bit sleepy. I was wondering what Derek was doing in the library and imagining he was having more fun than me. Then I rested my head on my desk just for a minute. And that's when Mr. Fullerman woke me up from the amazing dream I was having about being top of the class, getting voted to the school council and do three playing at the school. Me awake now. Trying really hard to keep my eyes open, while still wondering if Derek is having more fun than I am in this catch-up class in the library. A catch-up class quiz, brilliant, I was thinking. If I was in the library, I wouldn't have fallen asleep because I'd be able to hang out with Derek. I really want to swap classes, but I'm not sure how. I bet Mr. Fullerman won't let me go to the library, especially after I fell asleep. I'll have to come up with a very convincing plan, which could be tricky. As I'm thinking about what to do, Leroy Lewis puts up his hand and says, "Can I go and use the study books in the library, please, Mr. Fullerman?" Ha, like that's going to work. Mr. Fullerman only goes and says, "Okay, Leroy, they do have more study books there. I'll write a note to give you to Miss Lucas." I wasn't expecting that to happen. I watch Leroy take his note and go off to the library. Then I wait a few minutes before putting my hand up and asking the same question. I try hard to sound like I really want to use those study books and not just hang out with my best mate like I do. Then Mr. Fullerman says, "If I let you, Tom, what will you have to work on?" And I say the first thing that pops into my head, which is staying awake. Anything else? Reading the study books carefully and doing the test questions without all the doodles? It's a good answer, I think. "Make sure you do, Tom. Give this note to Mrs. Lucas and off you go quickly." I get a bit overexcited because I can't believe he's letting me go. "Yes, thank you, sir. That's brilliant," I shout, air punch. Then in case Mr. Fullerman gets suspicious, I add in a more sensible, less shouty voice, "This will help me a lot, Mr. Fullerman." I don't want him to think I might be trying to escape from the class, which might seem crazy, but that's exactly what Buster Jones tried to do last week. Buster Jones is older than me and in the year above. He's one of those kids who seems to get into trouble a lot for doing stupid things, like lying on the floor when he's not supposed to. "Get off the floor, Buster. It's comfy, miss." When Buster was in detention, he decided to try and escape through the glass window. He was on the ground floor. Even Buster's not that daft. Only he got stuck, properly wedged in. Some kids gathered around and just stared at him. Derek and I watched what was going on from a safe distance. Buster started to get really cross that he couldn't get out. "Don't just stand there looking at me. Help me out." So a few of them got hold of his leg and started to try and pull him out. But that didn't work. Buster tried wiggling from side to side, but he didn't budge at all. When the teacher, Mr. Sprocket, caught him trying to escape detention, he tried to pull Buster back into the classroom. It was like a tug of war. Buster wasn't happy. Mr. Keene saw what was going on from his office window, and he wasn't happy either. "What's going on down there?" Eventually, caretaker Stan had to be called to help free Buster from the window. He was in heaps of trouble after that. Detention, Buster. Mr. Keene made a special announcement over the tannoy telling the whole school that no one should ever try to climb out of a window, as it was very dangerous and they were likely to get stuck. "So I won't be doing anything like that before Mr. Fullerman changes his mind. I gather up my stuff. I'm feeling quite pleased with myself because I'm off to the library. Yeah. I can hang out with Derek. Yeah. I might actually do better in my chest. Yeah. Derek and I can sit together. Yeah. I don't have to pretend to like snacks. Yuck. Fred Galloway puts up his hand and asks if he can go to the library too. Why do you need to go, Brad? Mr. Fullerman asks. Because Tom's going, Brad says, which turns out to be the wrong answer. I mouth sorry, Brad, to him as I close the door and leave. As I'm on the way to the library, I hear a door open really loudly, followed by a very stompy footsteps coming up the stairs towards me. I don't really want to explain to another teacher what I'm doing. If it's Mr. Keane, he'll help me chatting for ages. Where are you going, Tom? So I make the quick decision to hop into the cloakroom near the library and hide until whoever it is has gone past. I can just about say out and I realise that it's not a teacher, it's Buster Jones. He looks like he's in a bit of a hurry. As he walks past me, I breathe a sigh of relief. Phew, that was close. I'm about to sneak out when Buster comes back. He stops in front of the glass cabinet where all the photos of the teachers are. I hold my breath and don't move. Buster is doing something, but I can't quite see what he is. What it is. He's laughing to himself. What seems like ages. He's very busy. When he finally leaves, I'm sure he's not coming back. I creep out of the cloakroom and take a look at what Buster's been up to. He's going to be in so much trouble if anyone finds out what he's done. Whoa. Mr. Keane. Mrs. Mumble. Mrs. Worthington. Mrs. Knapp. Mr. Fullerman. Mr. Sprocket. With all weird drawings on them. It's crazy. Buster's drawn all over the glass cabinet. While I'm staring at Buster's handiwork, Mrs. Lucas opens the library door and calls my name, Tom Gates, which makes me jump. Are you supposed to be in capture class now? Come along, don't stand around. I don't want her to see what Buster's done in case she thinks it was me who did it. So I quickly say, yes, miss. I'm coming to the library right now. Buster Jones has no idea what a lucky escape he's just had from a ton more detentions. Miss Lucas turns around and I follow her into the library. The first person I see is Derek, who looks up and waves. Miss Lucas, who's new in the school, is here to make sure we all do our work. I hand over my note and say, Mr. Fullerman says I can use the study books here to help me with my test. Mrs. Lucas reads my note and says, okay, Tom, find a seat. I head straight towards Derek when she adds, not there, this note says you and Derek chat too much. Thanks a lot, Mr. Fullerman. I sit as near to Derek as I can because I really want to tell him what Buster Jones did to the teacher's photos. Ha ha! Miss Lucas hands me the study book and some extra paper. You know what you have to do, don't you, Tom? Yes, Mrs. Lucas, I said. The first thing I try and do is tell Derek what happened, but he can't hear me, so I write him a note which makes it look like I'm working hard, when I'm really doing a drawing of Buster's graffiti. I finish my note and then give it to the kid in front of me so he can pass it to Derek. Psst, I whisper. Pass this note to Derek over there. The boy takes a note, opens it up and reads it. Hey Derek, guess what I just saw Buster Jones do? He drew graffiti all over the photos of the teachers in the glass cabinet. It's very funny, from Tom. It's not for you, I hiss. Pass it to Derek. But it's too late. Did Buster really do that? Do what, another kid asks. Just pass it on, I tell him. He does, but not to Derek. My note goes around practically the whole library and every kid has a look before Derek finally gets it. He mouths really at me. Then he writes something on a note and tries to throw it back. Only the note lands on the table next to mine. Mrs. Lucas looks up to see what's going on. No messing around, she says. We all pretend to be busy. I'll pick up the note later. For the next 10 minutes, I manage to get some work done while keeping an eye on the note. I'm thinking of just sneaking over to pick it up. When in walks Mr. Keane with Buster Jones by his side. Mr. Keane says, I'm sorry to interrupt, Miss Lucas. Buster needs to finish his detention in here. If you wouldn't mind, there's been an accident of graffiti which caretaker Stan has asked me to investigate. Buster is looking down and sort of smiling. Mr. Keane tells Buster, sit over there and no talking. You're here to finish off your work quietly. Okay, Buster? Buster mumbles, yes, sir. Over there turns out to be right next to me. Buster gets out his work while I keep my head down and stare at my back. When I think it's safe, I look up. Buster is staring at me, and not in a good way. He leans over and tries to talk to me. Psst, psst, Gatesy, Gatesy. I don't say a word, but inside my head I'm thinking, Gatesy, that's not my name. Buster likes to give everyone nicknames. I keep looking down. Then he says it again. Gatesy, you're good at drawing. How do I do this graph thing? He's holding up his work and he wants me to help him. Why me? I'm not sure what to do now. Mrs. Lucas spots Buster bothering me and says, Buster, leave Tom alone and concentrate on your own work, which is a relief. Then Buster says quietly, yes, Miss Mucus. Miss Lucas doesn't notice he's called her the wrong name. He'd get another detention if he did. Buster flicks through his book and then leans over to me again. Did you hear that, Gatesy? I said, Mrs. Mucus. Ha, I've got the nicknames for all the teachers. I still keep quiet. Buster doesn't know that some kids have a nickname for him too. They call him Bully Buster. But not to his face, obviously. Psst, psst. Gatesy, do you want to hear my nicknames for the teachers then? I do, but I don't want to get into trouble, so I don't say anything. Then he starts telling me anyway. Mr. Keen is Mrs. Mean. Mrs. Lucas is Miss Mucus, obviously. Mr. Sprocket is Mr. Muppet. Hello, I'm a Muppet. Miss Yoddle is Mrs. Sodal. Blah, 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 blah. I'm trying hard not to laugh, but I can't help it. Some of his names are funny. Buster sees I'm giggling, so he knows I'm listening to what he's saying. Then he adds, your teacher, Mr. Fullerman, I've got a really good nickname for him. Shall I tell you what it is? Yes, yes, I really want to know. I smile a bit, but I don't say anything out loud. Buster leans over close to me and says, it's a very long pause. Mr. Fullerbum. I do such a loud laugh. Ha ha ha! That even Buster surprised. Miss Lucas comes over and tells me to move to the end of the table and leave Buster alone, as if I'm the troublemaker. Derek is looking over and wondering why I'm laughing. I so want to tell him what Buster just said to me. He'll think it's so funny too. Ha, Mr. Fullerbum. I can't wait so I can tell Derek. Then I decide, why wait? I'll draw another note drawing on it and I'll throw it to him this time. Good plan. As I start drawing, my hand keeps wobbling because I'm laughing again. I'm trying not to laugh, but it isn't easy. Derek, this is why I was laughing. How funny is this nickname for Mr. Fullerman? Wait for it. Derek, this is why I was laughing. How funny is this nickname for Mr. Fullerman? Wait for it. Mr. Fullerman. P.S. This catch-up class is so boring and the test is so annoying. It's even funnier than Mrs. Worthingtash. From Tom. I'm so engrossed in my drawing that I don't realise Mr. Fullerman has walked into the library. He says something to Miss Lucas which makes me look up. Uh-oh. I'm just about to manage to cover my drawing with my hand, then I look around and grab a big book that's next to me and slip my hilarious drawing between the pages so he can't see it, which is a stroke of genius as Mr. Fullerman is suddenly standing behind me. Tom, have you finished all your work? I have, I say, hoping he doesn't spot my drawing. Mr. Fullerman tells me to gather everything up and come back to class before going home, so that's what I do. But I have a strange feeling that I'm getting stared at. I glance over to Buster. He's found the note. Derek threw at me. From the look on his face, he read it. Buster doesn't look happy. I've walked past him to leave the library and he says to me, Oi, Gatesy, you and your mate Derek need to keep this to yourselves, right? He's waving the note. I kind of nod as I squeeze past him to make a break for freedom. I can't wait to go home now. I'm in a big hurry to meet Derek at the school gate. When he turns up, the first thing we have to do is hide from Buster. I tell Derek everything that happened. Buster read the note about the graffiti. Oh no, Buster told me we have to keep it quiet. He doesn't know the whole library read the note though. All those kids. I saved the best until last. Buster has nicknames for the teachers and guess what he calls Mr. Fullerman? Tell me. Mr. Fullerbum. Derek's in stitches. Ha ha. We both are. Ha ha. I drew a picture of him to send you. It's really funny. Let me see it then, Derek says. And that's when I start thinking, what did I do with that picture? I have a horrible feeling that I might have left it in one of the library books. A Are you okay, Tom? Derek asked me. I'm not sure. I can't remember what I did with that picture. I could be in a lot of trouble if someone finds it. Why? A teacher could find out, I explained. They won't know you drew it, though. It's not like you wrote your name on it or anything. Let me think about that. Did I sign it? You didn't sign it, did you, Tom? Derek asked me, still thinking. Why would I sign it? That's a crazy thing to do, I tell him. You signed the drawing, didn't you? Maybe. I have to find it before anyone else does, for lots of reasons. It won't help my chances of being voted onto the school council. I think I wrote that tests were annoying too, I explained to Derek, and I drew Mrs. Worthingtash. I really need my drawing. All the way back home, I keep thinking that if someone finds my drawing. Derek is doing his best to make me feel everything will be fine, but it's not really working. What's the worst thing that can happen, he asks me. I can think of loads of bad things that could happen, I tell him. Tom Gates, what do you say about this? Actually, so can I. Detention forever, Tom. Like what, I want to know. Well, imagine if Mrs. Lucas finds the drawing. She could pass it on to Mr. Fullerman. He'd give you a detention for sure. If Mr. Fullerman was in a bad mood, he might send you to Mr. Keane. Do you think so? You might do. Then Mr. Keane could write a letter home to your mum and dad. Not another letter, I sigh. Because Derek goes into his house, he adds. Unless what, I want to know. Unless Bully Buster finds the drawing. Remember, he was in the library too. How could I forget? Gatesy. Buster might use the drawing to get himself out of trouble. You know what he's like. No, sir. I don't know who did the graffiti, but Tom Gates did this drawing. I didn't think about that. But that's not going to happen. It will probably get lost and no one will find it, so don't worry about it, Tom. Then Derek goes into the house. Bye! Everyone keeps telling me not to worry about things. Finding a half-eaten wafer at the bottom of my bag helps. A little. First thing tomorrow morning, I'm going back to the library to find the book I hid my drawing in, though I'm not totally sure which one it was. In my head, I'm thinking of a plan that will solve my very tricky problem. Also, in my head, I'm thinking how much easier everything would be if only I had just one or maybe two superpowers. Here are my top five superpowers. Super speedy. I could zoom back to school and whiz around the library until I found it, my drawing. Then I'd zip back home and be the first one at dinner. Super invisible. An excellent power for avoiding Mum and Dad when they want me to tidy stuff. Also good for avoiding Delia. Tom. Bully Buster and Mr. Fullerman, if he finds my drawing. Tom Gates, did you draw this? Invisible. Number 3. Super smart. Ask me anything. No more catch-up classes for me. I know the answers to everything Delia couldn't argue with me, and Marcus would have to stop bragging about how brilliant he is at tests. I'm good at tests. So am I. Number 4. Super flyer. Who doesn't want to fly? Bye. Superhuman memory. This would be so useful. With that superpower, I'd have remembered all the answers to the test. Tick. Being at the top of the class. Tick. Not being in catch-up class. Tick. Not done that drawing of Mr. Fullerman. Mr. Fullerbum. Tick. Not forgotten to take the drawing with me. Tick. Sadly, I don't have that superpower. I was so busy eating my old wafer, I completely forgot that Mum is working late tonight. Mum and Dad have both been really busy lately, especially Dad, who's spending loads more time in his shed. I think that's where he is now. Mum's left one of her notes on the fridge. I've read it, as it's all for us. Hi, family. I'm working late tonight, in case you've forgotten. Tom, I hope catch-up class went well. Don't worry about the test. Frank, as you're busy too, I've asked Granny Mavis to make dinner. Only kidding. Ha, I've already made it. It's in the fridge. Delia, could you be in charge heating up the dinner and dishing it out, please? That'd be very helpful. See you later. No arguing, please. Love, Mum. Kiss, kiss. As I read Mum's note, one bit makes me groan out loud. Delia could be in charge. Why? Delia already thinks she's the boss. Do as I say. When Mum and Dad aren't around, she's always trying to tell me what to do. Tom, do this. Tom, do that. She's done it before. Just in case dinner goes horribly wrong, sigh. getting burnt, that kind of thing. I decided to grab a snack now while no one's here. I spot a large bag of crisps on a high shelf. Seaweed and wood-flavoured crisps. Yuck, I'm not that desperate yet. I set up on a carton of drink, a banana and a packet of cheesy crackers. I put, hide, everything in my bag. Then go to say hi to Dad, who's out in his shed on the phone. I wave and he waves back. Then I rub my stomach and do, I'm really hungry. And I know you have a biscuit tin face, which works. Dad points to the tin and nods his head while he carries on talking. The good news, for me, is that there were cookies inside. There are a few fig rolls too, but I'm not touching those. If there's nothing else around, I might eat one, but I'm in luck today with the cookies. I take a bite out of a big one, then wave again at Dad as I leave. Dad looks surprised when he sees me eating the big cookie, like he'd forgotten it was there, he had. I whisper, there are still some fig rolls left, as I close the door behind me quietly. As I walk back to the kitchen, Rooster is jumping up and down the other side of the garden fence, like he knows I'm eating something tasty. No way, Rooster, I tell him as I head into the kitchen. Delia's come downstairs and she's reading Mum's note. I have to do everything around here. It's not fair. She's in a really grumpy voice. Straight away, I put the cookie in my bag so she can't see it and pinch it from me. That's happened before. Even with her sunglasses on, I can tell Delia's giving me a look. Hey, if you want dinner, you'll have to eat it now. I'm going out. It's a bit early for dinner, I pointed out. Tough. It's now or never, and Mum said you're not allowed to eat anything on the clean sofa or else. I'll eat dinner now then, like I have a choice. I bet Mum didn't say or else. That's just Delia being all bossy and thinking she's in charge. Delia waves me away with a hand saying, it's not ready yet. You don't need to be here, which suits me fine. I can finish off my cookie and watch some TV without her bothering me. It also takes my mind off Mr. FB drawing I left in the library. That's what I'm calling it from now on. I might get a brainwave and suddenly remember exactly which book I left it in with my superhuman memory brainwave, if only. I head off to the living room when I make some room on the sofa to spread myself out by chucking the scatter cushions on the floor. Once I'm comfy, I start watching cartoons while eating my cookie. Every time I laugh, crumbs go flying all over the place. I use my hand to sweep them into a neat pile, then carefully push them onto the floor. I'm still enjoying my cookie when I think I can hear Delia coming to get me. Hidden cookie. So I shove what's left of it under my leg, which seemed like a sensible thing to do. Cookie under his leg. I'm waiting for her to come in. But there's no sign of her so far. Nope, it's a false alarm. So I take out my cookie and that's when I spot a problem. Some of the chalk chips have melted onto my leg and on the sofa as well. The sofa that I'm not supposed to eat on or else. Rubbing the stain with my hand only makes it worse. And much bigger too. It's almost the same size as one of the scatter cushions now, which gives me an idea. I lean over the sofa to find one of the cushions and then carefully place it over the stain, which works a treat. You can't see a thing anymore, but then I spot another problem, exactly where I was kneeling. It's another stain. Oh, great. I grab a different cushion and cover that one too. Now seems like a good time to go into the kitchen, even if dinner isn't ready yet. Delia is as pleased to see me as ever. Your dinner's over there. I'm far too nice to you, she says, pointing to my feet. You're not that nice, I tell her. I made you pie. How much nicer could I be? Delia tries to convince me. What's in the pie? It might be something I don't like. Just eat it, Mr. Fussy, Delia tells me sternly. I need you to do something useful for a change and tell Mum and Dad that I'm at a friend's house. But I won't be back late, okay? What are you going to tell them? You've got no friends and you're going to be really late, I tell her. Ha ha. Very funny, Tom. Thank you, I say, and ask her what's in the pie again. Delia doesn't answer. She's ignoring me. And I'm getting hungry. I eat some anyway, and it's delicious. Do you like it then, Tom? Delia says before she leaves. What kind of pie is it? I ask her again with my mouth full. Didn't I tell you? Just slug and crunchy frog. Enjoy. I know Delia's joking, but it just doesn't taste the same now. I still eat it, though. The green beans I spread around the plate so it looks like I've had most of them. There's a real skill to hiding food so that you don't like. I do it at school and at Granny Mavis's house. Lumpy mince hidden under my cutlery. Tuna and mushrooms hidden under my mashed potato. It's especially useful if you don't like tuna. That fish is always popping up where you least expect it. Tuna in burger. Tuna hiding in pasta. Tuna potato wedges. As I finish my dinner, sort of, I head upstairs to my room. I can still see Derek from my window, which reminds me about my lost FB drawing. I wonder if Derek can remember what book I left it in. I can't. I write out a sign and put it up at my window to ask Derek, who looks confused. Can you remember which book I left my drawing in? Huh? I have a feeling that the book had birds on it, so I do another sign. I draw the book on one side and Mr. Fullerbum on the other. Was it a book on bird watching? Mr. Fullerbum. Ha ha ha! Derek. Which makes Derek laugh, and I start laughing too. I don't notice Dad is in the room until he says, "What's so funny, Tom?" He finished work and has come upstairs to see me. I'm holding my FB drawing so tightly so Dad can't see it. Nothing, it's just Derek's being funny. I'll tell Dad, a bird-watching book. Are you interested in bird-watching then? Dad must have read my sign, so I say, yes, I'm very interested. I'm taking this book out to the library tomorrow. Your uncle Kevin and I used to go out bird-watching when we were kids. Kevin had all the right gear to wear. You can imagine, Dad laughs. I can. How about we read a story together once I've had dinner? I nod enthusiastically. Speaking of dinner, I'm surprised you had room for yours after eating my big cookie. Oops. I left loads of fig rolls and a cookie for you. The small one? Yes, I saw that. I was very hungry and Delia told me that dinner was slug and crunchy frog pie. It almost put me off, I pointed out. Dad laughs and says, that sounds like something Granny Mavis would make. I hope you left some for me. Loads. I'm still holding on to my drawing when Dad goes downstairs to eat. While I'm waiting for him to come and read stories, I brush my teeth and get ready for bed, then think about which book would be good to choose. I pick out a few and wait. When I can't wait any longer, I go downstairs to see where he is. Mum's just come back from work and is surprised to see me. You still up? I thought you'd be in bed now. Then Mum gives me a hug and asks me about catch-up class. It was okay, but then Delia said dinner was slug and crunchy frog pie. Is Delia here? Mum wants to know. This is what I'm supposed to say, that Delia is at her friend's and won't be late. Instead, I say something that sounds a bit similar. Delia's gone out to buy a pet. A pet? Are you sure? That's all I need. I just say, because Mum looks a bit cross, and I was only joking. Where's your dad? In the shed, she asks. I came down to find him. He said we'd read a story before bed. Sorry, Tom. Let's go and see where he's got to. Dad's not in the kitchen or in the shed. And we go back to the kitchen. Mum says, well, he's eating, I can see that. Empty plate. Then we head to the front room and there's Dad lying on the sofa. Brilliant, Mum says, but not in a good way. Dad's fast asleep with the TV on and he's clutching a half-eaten, slightly melted chocolate chip cookie. Now you can see why I don't like anyone eating on the sofa. Tom, look at those chocolate stains under his leg. I'd forgotten about those. Mum thinks the stains are Dad's fault. I decide that now is a good time to go back to bed, just before Mum wakes Dad up. I still have those snacks in my school bag too. We're all having breakfast when Mum says, do you know how long it took me to get those chocolate stains out of the sofa last night? I keep quiet, and so does Dad. I was expecting Delia to say something to me about the pet joke, but Mum must have forgotten about it when she saw the sofa stains, so that's good. Then Mum says, while I remember, I might have to work this weekend, and your dad's kindly volunteered to help me. Have I? Dad says, sounding surprised. Yes, Frank. And Tom, We really need you to do something for us, Mum adds. Whenever Mum says that, it doesn't end the way I hope it might. We really need you to do something for us. Tidy your room. Be nice to your sister. Find Grandad's teeth. So I'm waiting to hear what they need me to do. We really need you to go to your cousin's during the day. Which is not so bad, but I have a better idea. Can I go to Derek's house instead? I can see that Mum is trying to work out a reason to say no. Derek's Mum and Dad are very busy, and you can't just stay. And you can't stay here because Delia's going out. Delia says, shame. But I'm glad I don't have to stay with her. You have fun at the cousins, don't you? Dad asks me. Sometimes, I say, which is true. I have more fun at Derek's. I know what you mean, Dad says, agreeing with me. I wish Granny Mavis and Grandad Bob were here. Then I could go and hang out with them. But they're on holiday. We've had a postcard from them already. They look like they're having a great time. I hope you have a good time at the cousins, now that I don't have a choice about going. Dear everyone, we're having a wonderful time on the ship, though it took a while to get used to the waves. One was big. Bob's teeth flew out of his mouth and landed in a lady's dinner. So far, we've been swimming, dancing, and water skiing, which was great fun. The postcard is a photo the crew took of us. Lots of love, Bob and Mavis. Here are all the reasons I need to get my FB drawing back. Number one, if Mr. Fullerman sees my drawing, I'm in trouble. Number two, if Mrs. Lucas finds my drawing, I'm in trouble. Number three, if Bully Buster finds my drawing, he'll get me into trouble. Number four, if Mr. Keane gets shown my drawing, I'll be in trouble. Number five, if Mum and Dad are told about my drawing, I'll be in huge trouble. I could go on. I have a plan. On my way to school, I explain my plan to Derek, who's keen to help. My plan goes like this. Go to the library, find book, find drawing in book, take drawing in book back, show drawing to Derek, high five, then get rid of drawing for good. Derek says, it's a good plan. The first person we see in school is Norman. He's excited to tell us something. I have new glasses. They look exactly the same to me. Then Norman tells us he's learning a new instrument but won't tell us what it is. He says it's a surprise. I'll bring it over to band practice and play you my new tune. He doesn't know that it's been cancelled. It's cancelled, sorry Norman. Oh, he does know now. Mr. Keane is standing by the door and saying hello as kids walk into school while doing a spot check on school uniform. No capes or masks, boy in a cape. Really? Then Mr. Keane says to me, good morning, Tom. It sounds like he's just said, good drawing, Tom. Like he's seen my drawing. He hasn't. Morning, sir, I say. Then tell Derek, we need to go to the library now. I'll cover for you if Mr. Fullerman asks where you are, Norman says. Thanks, Norman. It's a good idea, but not part of the plan. I just hope whatever Norman tells Mr. Fullerman will make sense. Tom's not here because he's been taken away by aliens. Caretaker Stan is still cleaning off the pen marks that Buster drew on the glass cabinet. Bully Buster was here, I whisper to Derek as we walk past. Derek says, oh, no, he's not. He's over there. We managed to avoid Buster by hiding behind our bags. Then make it to the library without being stopped by any teachers or bumping into Buster again. But when we get there, it's closed. Oh no, I sigh. We press our faces up against the glass and take a good look through the door. Can you see anything? Derek asks me. Books. Lots of books, I say, like that wasn't obvious already. Then I spot a book that might be the one. It's the Big Book of Birdwatching. I think that's the book I put the drawing into, I tell Derek. We have to get it right now, I say excitedly. Right now, you boys should be in class. Mrs. Knapp says, which makes us both jump. Yes, Mrs. Knapp, we're going now. She watches us leave, and I tell Derek, we'll have to come back later. Maybe lunchtime. I know it's in there. Plan B it is then. Luckily, I'm not that late for class, but I wonder if Norman has made an excuse for me already. From the way Mr. Funman is looking at me, I'm guessing he might have. Hurry up, Tom. I'm glad to see Giant Bird Norman Saw didn't pick you up and take you away forever. As I sit down, Marco says, Hello, Gatesy. How does he know that Bully Buster was calling me that? I think it's a catchy nickname, Gatesy, he says again. That's not my name, Marcus Meldrewy, I say to show him how annoying it is. Tom's got a new nickname, Marcus says to Amy. No, I haven't. It's Gatesy, 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 Gatesy. Marcus starts singing it. It's not my new nickname, I tell Amy again. Whatever, you're both being annoying, she says, which shuts us up. But not for long. I heard that Buster Jones has got funny nicknames for all the teachers too, Marcus says. I'm not going to tell Marcus what they are, because he'll blab them to everyone, even the teachers. Mr. Sprocket, do you know that Buster calls you Mr. Muppet? Instead, I pick up my pen and start doodling a few nickname ideas of my own. Not for me, for Marcus, who's leaning over my shoulders. Marcus Melon. Melon Marcus. Hey, that's my name, Marcus says. Nothing gets past you, Marcus, I say, and carry on doodling. This could be your new nickname, Marcus. Marcus Meldrew, written backwards, is Wordlum Skookram. He's not impressed. That's a rubbish nickname. I like M. Drew. It sounds like a proper name. M. Drew. That sounds like you're saying Andrew, but with a really posh voice. Ha, Amy laughs when I say that. Marcus doesn't. Lots of famous people use their initials, so I could be MM. I like that, he tells me. Loads of ideas flood into my head of what MM could stand for, so I carry on doodling. MM, Mini Marcus. Squeak! MM, Marcus Meldrew. Squeak. I'm so busy doodling that I didn't hear Mr. Fullerman call my name until he says it out loud. Drawing again, Tom. I put down my pen and look up slowly. Oh, this drawing, sir. I'm just doodling. You've been doing far too much doodling lately, Tom, haven't you? I hope he isn't talking about that drawing. I say, yes, sir, I have. Then I wait to see what else he has to say. Plan B needs to be put into action as soon as possible. Because I have to get that drawing back so I can start worrying about who might find it. What were you thinking, Tom? This is not what I expect from you, Tom. Is this me? Disappointed, Tom. You're in trouble, Gatesy. Oh, dear. This whole situation is getting trickier and trickier. Plan B, it is. Countdown to school election. 3. But first, drama. Before I can go back to the library, we have a drama lesson in the hall. Mr. Fullerman takes us all downstairs, and we walk past the library on the way. If only I could just nip inside and grab the book, then, ta-da, everything would be sorted. But the door's still closed, so I'm going to have to wait. Sigh. A superpower would really come in handy right now, that's for sure. Most of the time, drama lessons are okay. Some are more fun than others, depending on who's taking the class. Mr. Fullerman always makes us do these weird face exercises before we start. Ooh, Sometimes we have to swing our arms around, shake our hands, spinning in a circle can be tricky if you end up near Norman or Julia Morton. I feel sick. Once Mrs. Knapp took us for drama class and she made us pretend to be blocks of ice that start to melt. Some kids really got into it, especially Solid, who made an excellent ice cube. He said it was a very hot day and that's why he melted quickly. Melted splodge. Today's lesson sounds okay though. Mr. Fullerman wants us to make up a short scene from a day in the life of the school and act it out. You could choose something real or use your imagination to think of something that has never happened before in school. Like nice school dinner, sir. Brad Galloway suggests, which makes us all laugh. I'm thinking that this could be a really good lesson and a lot of fun. Then Marcus gets put into my group. Hello, Gatesy, he says to me, which straight away is annoying. So I say, hello, Wordlum. That's your new nickname. Marcus doesn't call me Gatesy again. Amy, Solid, Florence and Trevor Peters are in our group too. Normally, when it comes to deciding what our play is going to be about, we wouldn't get a word in edgeways with Marcus. Listen to me! But Sola comes up with a brilliant idea that we all agree on, even Marcus. Yeah, it's okay. Genius. We're going to act out the time when Buster Jones got stuck in the window. Marcus is Mr. Keen, who gets cross. He'll be good at that. Solid is Buster. Florence is the teacher, and the rest of us are the kids who tried to pull Buster out. Our rehearsal goes pretty well. I'm pretending to heave Solid through the window with Trevor. Solid is doing a good job of being stuck. But when we do the whole scene in front of the class, Marcus gets carried away, pretending to be Mr. Keen, and blurts out, "Right, Buster, detention for a whole year." Everyone laughs. Solid says, "A year? Make it 2 years, because I know it was you who drew all those moustaches and graffiti on the teacher's photos." What? I can't believe he's just gone and said that. Marcus has just told the whole class and Mr. Fullerman that Buster did the graffiti. We finish our little school play and get a big round of applause. "What did you say that for?" "Clap, clap, clap, clap," I whisper to Marcus. "I'll just say I made it all up. It's called acting." He sounds very sure of himself. While we watch the other plays, I remind Marcus, if Buster gets found out, he'll think it was me who blabbed and told everyone. "You did tell everyone," Marcus looks at me puzzled. "No, I didn't. I just drew a picture on a note for Derek. That's all. Adam Bright told me your note got passed around the whole library in catch-up class, so everyone knew it was Buster. Then he went and told me. They just read it. I didn't say they could. Who else have you told?" I asked Marcus. "Just a few kids." "How few?" "Not many." He means everyone. "So much for trying to keep things quiet." "Keep it to yourself," Buster told me and Derek. "There's no chance now." Mr. Fullerman congratulates the whole class for all the excellent plays we put on. Our group gets a special mention for some excellent acting. But let's make sure none of you do what Buster tried to do. No escaping from lessons, okay? "Yes, sir," we all say. Walking back to class, I can see the library is now open at last. That's the first place I'm going to go when the bell goes. There's 10 minutes to go before lunch, and Mr. Fullerman wants us all to have some quiet and calm time. "Let's all take a moment to relax," he says, while wafting his arms around. It's not easy to do when I have so many things on my mind, like tests, lost drawing, Buster. Mr. Fullerman suggests that we fill in our reading records, get out our books, and even catch up with some other work. Marcus starts humming, which is annoying, and not very relaxing at all. So to help me zone out Marcus, I do a doodle instead. It's amazing how much it helps. I keep going until the bell goes for lunch. Norman says he'll come with me to the library to help look for you know what. Straight away, Marcus is being nosy. "What are you looking for?" "Nothing," we both say. "I'm not telling Marcus, that's for sure." In the library, Mrs. Lucas asks us, "Are you looking for something in particular, boys?" "I'm looking for a book," I say. "We have a lot of those here," she laughs. "It's a special book. A big book," Norman adds. "Well, the big reference books are over there, but you better be quick because I have a club starting soon, and they'll all be sitting in that section too," she says, pointing to where the big books are. "Right, okay, plan B," I say to Norman. Then I head towards my catch-up class seat and look around to see if I can spot my drawing in any of the books. Norman starts reading, which isn't exactly helpful, but I leave him to it. There's a lot of big books now, and I can't remember which one it was. The Big Book of Animals, The Big Book of Planets, The Big Book of Cooking. I start flicking through some of them as the book club kids start to arrive and sit down around me. My drawing's not here, but I keep looking carefully. As more and more book club kids sit down around me, then I suddenly spot The Big Book of Bird Watching. Yes, it might be that one. I grab it and hold on tightly. "Have you found the right book?" Mrs. Lucas asks me. "I need to start book club now if you want taken one out." "This one, please, Miss Lucas." Norman is still reading. "Trust you to pick a reference book. That's not supposed to be taken out the library," she tells me. I can't look for my drawing surrounded by all these book club kids. So I ask Mrs. Lucas again and do a sad face. "Okay, Tom, just this once. but keep a close eye on it and don't leave it lying around. Take it home with you, then bring it back tomorrow, okay? It won't leave my side, I say. Norman is still reading. Miss Lucas makes a note of which one I'm taking. Don't forget, Tom, look after this book, won't you? I take the big book of bird watching and head out the door. Norman decides to start jumping behind me. Plan B is nearly complete. Did my jumping work then? Norman says. Yes, I tell Norman, because I just want to look through the book and find my Mr. FB drawing at last. I'm trying to flick through the pages and walk at the same time, which is not easy to do. Norman is still jumping. We meet up with Solid and Derek, who asks me, did you find the you-know-what yet? I pick up the book and shake it, but my drawing doesn't fall out. Oh no, don't tell me I've got the wrong book. I was looking forward to seeing your drawing, Norman says. I'm not doing another one. Derek, Norman and Solid look disappointed for me. It's not inside this book, so it must still be in the library, I say. Plan C it is then. I'm not sure exactly what Plan C is yet. Norman starts jumping again and says I've got something good to tell you. So we all listen carefully. Did you know that if you put the word chicken in front of your surname, it sounds like a proper fancy dinner? No, we did not. Try it, Norman suggests. So we did. Some names work better than others. Chicken Meldrew, Chicken Fingal, Chicken Stewart, Chicken Lewis, Chicken Worthington, Chicken Gates, Chicken Porter, Chicken Galloway, Chicken Keen, Chicken Fullerman. It's the best thing I've done all week. Now I have to lug the big book of bird watching around in class. Other kids are looking at me, probably thinking, why the big book? So I put it on the floor under my table before Marcus turns up. Then I find myself doodling, like you do, on the edge of my desk. Look, it's two monsters hanging around. I stop drawing when Mr. Fullerman says, can you all listen, please? Pen down. I don't have to remind you that drawing on school property is taken very seriously indeed. Whoops. I cover up my monsters fast and pretend I haven't drawn anything at all. I think he's talking about the graffiti Buster Jones did. Technically, I didn't actually see Buster draw in the glass. I just saw what it looked like after he'd finished. Marcus is sitting next to me now, and for a change, doesn't say anything either. I really don't want to tell on Buster Jones, that's for sure. I've been trying to avoid him, which hasn't been easy. Everywhere I go, he seems to be there, kind of glaring, while I've been hiding. Which won't be so easy to do now I have this massive book to look after. I could leave it at school now. I know my drawing's not inside. What I really need to do is go back to the library and swap it for the right book that has my drawing inside. I could get Norman to do some more jumping to distract Miss Lucas while I find a different book. As I'm working out Plan C, Mr. Fullerman says in front of the whole class, Tom, Miss Lucas wants me to remind you to take your big book of bird watching home with you. Do you have it here? Yes, sir. He waits for me to show him. Now my whole class have seen I have a bird watching book. Are you really interested in bird watching, Tom? Amy asks me, looking at the book. I should say no. Instead, I hear myself say, yes, I am. What do you know about bird watching? Then she asks, loads of interesting stuff about birds and how I watch them. That makes you twitcher. A twitcher, Amy laughs, which sounds a bit harsh if you ask me. I smile at first and pretend not to be bothered. Then I say, you're right. I am a twit for getting such a heavy book. You're a twit. Sure, Tom. It's someone who watches birds. I'm not saying you're a twit, Amy explains. I am. You're a twit, Marcus says, joining in. That's all I need. Why have you got out a bird watching book anyway? That's weird, he adds. It's a secret. I was going to tell you, but you're not great at keeping secrets. Marcus hates not being told secrets. Oh, go on, tell me. I won't say anything. Well, are you sure you want to know? Yes. I've heard that if you have an unusual hobby, it helps you get elected to the school council. The teachers love it. Really, it's true. Marcus has already made a list of reasons to vote for him. He thinks I might steal it, so he's got his arm over it. I bet he adds an unusual hobby to his list now. This afternoon, we're all going to be working on our school council election posters. It's turning out to be a quite good day after all. If I don't think about my missing drawing and quite a few other things too. Here are top 5 reasons to be voted on the school council. You go to meetings and say things like, the school day should be much shorter. You wear a fancy badge. School council. You get to stay inside when it's raining. Little kids think you're very important. Being a school councillor would really annoy Marcus. It's worth doing it just for that. Mr. Fullerman explains that part of the lesson today is making a poster for yourself. I made up person or even a creature. Mark Clump puts up his hand because he doesn't know what Mr. Fullerman means. So he shows us by drawing a poster as if he was a giant. Vote for me, giant, because I will scare other giants away, shelter you on school sports day if it rains, eat all the school dinners you don't like. We all get it now. Making our posters for school council election feels more like an art class, which I'm very happy about. There's coloured paper, scissors, pens, pencils and all kinds of stuff to use. Me! Marcus puts up his hands and volunteers to take the register back to the school office, which suits me fine, because I get to pick out what paper and pens I want to use. He's been gone for ages now. Not that I mind. It's more peaceful without him around. Marcus has left his list about why he should vote for him on his desk. I can't resist Quick Peek while he's not there. Interesting. There are so many things I could add, but I don't. Vote for me to be school councillor, Marcus Meldrew, MM for short. Because I am very popular, I am very smart, I'm good at lots of things. My unusual hobby is collecting dinosaurs. I have nice clear handwriting. Useful. I would be good for the job. I'm going to do a really big poster, cover with my doodles and make it stand out. I've drawn it in pencil. Now all I need is a felt tip to colour it in with. My one has run out. I need more pens. I start using the thin black felt tip. It's going to take me a long time to colour in the whole poster with this thin pen. It'll be worth it when Marcus comes back. He's really out of breath. You were gone for a long time, Marcus, Mr. Fullerman says to him. Sorry, sir. I had to wait for Miss Mumble. Marcus picks up some paper, then looks over my poster and says, that looks complicated. You've been gone for a long time, I remind him. I got stuck waiting for Mrs. Mumble, and Buster Jones was in the office too, waiting for Mr. Keane. He was. Did he say anything to you? Sort of. Not much. That's going to take you a lot of time to colour in, he asked, looking at my face again. My pen stopped working. I've only got this pen now. Here, have this thick black marker pen. You can use this. Really? Well, thanks, Marcus, I say, and I start using it. It's a really good marker pen he's given me. This is perfect. It would have taken me ages to finish off otherwise. I say sometimes Marcus can be the most annoying boy in the whole class, and then he goes and does something nice that helps me out. Nice. Then finishing off colouring in my poster with the good pen, the tannoy system starts to crackle. It's Mr. Keane. He sounds a bit stone. Oakfield School. I'm very disappointed. Once again, more graffiti has been found. Someone has been defacing school property with a thick black marker pen. If anyone knows anything about this, please tell your teacher. Thank you. Did Mr. Keane just say thick black marker pen? I think he did. I don't know anything about it, Marcus says. He's not in not a very convincing way. Did you do the graffiti with this pen, Marcus, I ask, because he looks a bit shifty. No, it wasn't me. Where did you get this pen from, Marcus? I don't want Mr. Keane thinking I drew the graffiti. Marcus leans closer and whispers, shh, keep your voice down. I'll tell you what happened, but you have to keep quiet. That depends. Keep going. So Marcus explains why he gave me the guilty pen. I volunteered to take the register down to the school office. I wanted to be helpful so Mr. Fullerman and the class would notice and think I'd be a good school counsellor. You need to do a lot more than that. Very funny. Anyway, Mrs. Mumble was busy talking on the phone, so I had to wait and guess who else was waiting to see Mr. Keane. Who? Guess. Buster Jones. Correct. So what happened next? Buster told me Mr. Keane wanted to talk to him about the graffiti. He said he knew nothing about it really loudly in case Mrs. Mumble could hear him. Did he? Then while I was still waiting for Mrs. Mumble, Buster asked if I wanted a pen. He told me it was a special pen, but he didn't need it anymore and I'd be doing him a favour, so I took the pen. Did you think that was a bit weird? Buster's not easy to say no to. Besides, I thought maybe he was being nice to me. I thought you were being nice to me as well, not just getting rid of the evidence. Okay, I admit, it crossed my mind he was giving me the graffiti pen. But you need a new pen, and besides, now Mr. Fullerman loves your poster. How do you know? He's holding it up. Well done, Tom. This is a very good poster. Can anyone see how Tom's used a thick black marker pen to make his messages stand out? They can now. I wish Mr. Fullerman would stop saying thick black marker pen. I managed to accidentally, on purpose, lose it in the class pen box. Hopefully, that pen won't find its way back to me. Not thanks to Marcus. My poster does look pretty good, though, which is something. Plan A, B, C. Or is it D? The next part of my plan is to go back to the library again and have a sneaky peek in a few more books. My drawing must be there somewhere. There's no point in taking the big book of bird watching home now. I take the book and drop it on my chair. Then I push the chair under the table to hide it. No one notices, so I head off to the library, fast. Derek's waiting for me at the school gate, so I can't be too long. But when I get there's a problem. Computer club is on, and there's loads of kids sitting exactly where I want to be. Then Miss Lucas spots me and straight away she asks, "I'm here for computer club." "No, miss." Did I need something else? "Yes, miss." "Did I still have the bird watching book?" "Yes." I tell Miss Lucas that Derek is keeping it safe for me while I'm here. He's waiting outside. "I just need to check a few more books." "I can't let you take another reference book out, Tom," she tells me. "You promised you'd look after the bird book." "I really am," I say, nodding. Miss Lucas might have been a little more convinced if Trevor Peters hadn't suddenly turned up slightly out of breath and puffing while holding the book. "Tom, I've been trying to catch up with you. This book's heavy. Mr. Fullerman said you left it on your chair and you need to bring it home with you." "Did I? How did that happen?" "Uh-oh." Luckily for me, Mrs. Lucas needs to start the computer club, so all the kids are waiting for her. So I promise not to let this book out of my sight and manage to convince Mrs. Lucas that I'm a responsible and trustworthy kid who will look after the birdwatching book and bring it back tomorrow. Make sure you do, Tom. When Derek sees me, "You were ages. That book looks heavy." "It is, but I have to bring it home with me." As we walk home, slowly in my case, I start to tell Derek how Marcus gave me the pen Buster had used to do the graffiti. "No way," Derek says. Then I drew my whole entire school council vote for me poster with it. "Did you hear Mr. Keane's announcement?" "Did I?" Then Derek starts doing a weird face as I tell him. Having Buster's pen and listening to Mr. Keane talking about the graffiti was really awkward. "No, this is going to be awkward," Derek says. "Hey, Gatesy, Marcus Meldrew said he gave you my pen and I need it back. Buster Jones has caught up with me and Derek. It's too late to hide." I panic and tell him the truth. "I did have it, but it's in the class pen box now. Sorry, Buster." "Tom, didn't know it was your pen," Derek adds. "Good point. Thanks, Derek." Buster scowls, then says, "That's okay, I have other pens, just as long as you haven't said anything about you know what." We both shake our heads. "No, we haven't." "Good. I'll see you around, Gatesy and Pingle." Then just when we think he's about to go, Buster adds, "What's with the big book of bird watching, Gatesy?" "I'm not going to tell him about my missing drawing, so I just say, well, I thought I'd left something inside, but it wasn't there, and now I have to take the book home with me." Annoying. Oh well. We watch Buster walk off down the road. Do you think he's going to call me Pingle all the time now? Back at home, I'm about to dump my bag and book down when I hear voices. Dad's in the kitchen having a cup of tea with Uncle Kevin, which is good news because tea equals biscuits. So I go and join them. I thought I'd check their house was okay while they're away, Uncle Kevin is saying. "It looks like they're enjoying themselves," Dad says while reading a new postcard from the fossils. "I could do with a holiday," Dad adds. Me too, I agree, as I put down my big book and bag. We always plan our holidays way in advance. We're very organised like that. Uncle Kevin tells Dad. He doesn't answer him. Help yourself to a biscuit, Tom. Good day at school. Before I can answer, Uncle Kevin notices the book. Look at that. Do you like bird watching, Tom? Uncle Kevin asks. I'm about to say, not really, when Uncle Kevin starts looking through the book and telling me all kinds of things about birds. Do you know what you're called if you go bird watching? Here we go. Dad is rolling his eyes. Yes, you're a twit. I mean, and you a twitcher? I say, which makes Dad laugh. We used to get taken bird watching by our dad, didn't we, Frank? Yes, we did. You always had the proper clothes, and I seem to remember you took my best binoculars. I don't think so. I would have had my own pair. Before Uncle Kevin goes home, he says, Hey, Tom, I could take you bird watching when you come over at the weekend if you like. I try to say, Oh, I'm not sure, but Uncle Kevin doesn't really listen. It'll be fun. I can show you all kinds of interesting things. Huh. That'll be a first, then, Dad laughs. Very funny, Frank. Once Uncle Kevin has left, Dad starts telling me his side of the birdwatching story. Just for the record, he did pinch my binoculars. I remember that very well. If you say so, Dad, I say between mouthfuls of biscuit. Since I've lugged this birdwatching book home with me, I might have as well have another look at it. I carry it up to my room and go through every page, just in case. The bad news is, my drawing definitely isn't there. But I knew that already. The good news is, I know a lot more about birdwatching, which isn't really good news. But it will have to do for now, as I still have to work on Plan E for school tomorrow. In my head, everything goes smoothly. Part 1. Avoid Bully Buster. I try to do that anyway. Part 2. Take the bird book back to the library. Part 3. Find the right book, the one with my drawing. Part 4. Keep hold of the drawing forever. Part 5. Cheer and high five a lot. Countdown to school election. Plan E. My plan doesn't exactly start off like it's supposed to. I wake up late, yawn. Mum and Dad shout at me to hurry up, get going. 2. I miss Derek, who's already left for school. 3. I have to walk on my own and carry the heavy birdwatching book the whole way, which slows me down even more. 4. The first person I see at school is Buster Jones. I hide behind the book. Part 5. I have to apologise to Mr. Fullerman for being late, still holding the book. Sorry, sir. Then Mr. Fullerman actually suggests that I should take the book straight down to the library, which is brilliant because that means I can get my drawing. Right now, I'm back on track with my plan. Norman waves at me, but I can't wave back as the book is heavy. Miss Lucas is very pleased to see me and to get the book back in one piece. Well done, Tom. I hope it was useful to you. You've been here a lot recently, haven't you? She doesn't mention the drawing, so that's good. I need another book, Miss Lucas, I explain. Miss Lucas seems a bit surprised. Another bird book? Is there a school project on bird watching at the moment? Not that I know of. I just wondered because Buster Jones was here in the morning and he did exactly the same thing as you. He was looking through the other copy of the bird watching book. Did Miss Lucas just say the other copy of the bird watching book? Yes, Tom. We have 2 copies of that book in the library. That's why I let you take this one out. And Buster was reading it, I asked, because that seems a bit odd. I was as surprised as you. Then Miss Lucas tells me that he seemed to be really enjoying it. He was laughing a lot. I had to ask him to keep down. I thought it was a bit strange because I've read that book and it's not funny at all. Is the book still here? I asked her. Yes, over there. Miss Lucas points it out. I rush over to take a look myself. It's exactly the same book as the other one I've just taken back. I go through it page by page. No, no, not there. No, no, no. I keep going. But then I come across a bit of paper stuck in the middle of the book. It looks like it's been ripped out in a hurry. I recognise the handwriting because it's my handwriting. I think Buster Jones has found my drawing. Evidence. None of that was in my plan at all. No wonder Buster was laughing at the book. Did you find what you were looking for, Tom? Miss Lucas asks. I take out the scrap of paper. Or can I find you another book on birds? She adds. No, what I want isn't here at all. I tell her, Plan F for failure. That's what this is. I walk back to class and decide to put Plan G into action. Plan, get my drawing back. Top 5 things that are not easy to do for me right now. Number 1, get my drawing back from Buster. Number 2, not panic, that Buster has my drawing. Number 3, find Buster and take back my drawing. Number 4, listen to Marcus, chat, at all. Number 5, be enthusiastic about going to see the cousins at the weekend. I tell Derek at lunch break that I think Buster has my drawing and show him the scrap of paper. If he has your drawing, he's not going to just hand it back to you, is he? It's a good point. Maybe we could sneak it back from him when he's not looking. How? I ask, because I have no idea at all. Follow me. We go and find Buster, who's standing around the school grounds. When I say find, I mean we can see him from a safe distance, behind a wall. Buster has his bag with him, and as we watch, he takes out what looks like a piece of paper. What's that? Derek says to me. It could be my drawing, I say. We try and get closer to have a proper look. Closer and closer. The trouble is, caretaker Stan is keeping an eye on us. He's wondering what we're up to. I can tell. So we make our way back to where he came from and leave Buster with my drawing. It's like in a big computer game, isn't it? Derek says. I know exactly what he means. Bully Buster is the graffiti kid who's stolen my drawing. I have to get it back when he's not looking. Caretaker Stan is on lookout. He's trying to catch the graffiti kid red-handed. But what if he thinks it's me who did the graffiti and he catches me before I find my drawing and the bell goes? It's game over. Caretaker Stan has been making a special effort to look out for anyone who is behaving suspiciously around school. I saw him looking very closely at the pen marks on my school counsellor poster, as if he was trying to remember where he'd seen that pen before. I haven't done anything wrong, but every time I see Caretaker Stan, it feels like I've got an arrow over my head that says, it was me, I did it, thick black marker pen. It probably hasn't helped that I've been holding a pen doing some drawing the last few times he's spotted me. I love doodling and drawing pens. But hey, thanks to Buster's pen, at least my school council election poster looks pretty good. There's only a few days to go before the vote, and all the posters are up around school. Some are more convincing than others. Tom's poster. School councillor. Vote for Tom Gates. What I'll do if you vote for me. Monday will be fun day, not the day everyone dreads. Tuesday is you Tuesday. Wear what you like to school. Wednesday means it's Pens Day, drawing and doodling in every class for extra merits. Thursday is now Thursday, bring your pet to school day. Friday will be surprise day, such as extra puddings or much bigger portions at lunchtime. This Alison Waters poster. Vote for me, Alison Water, because I bring in lots of good things. No school uniform, much nicer school dinners, nice homework and no homework at all. Vote for Marcus Meldry. Me. I am very popular, I am very smart, I am good at lots of things. My unusual hobby is collecting dinosaurs. I would do a good job. I have nice clear handwriting. Johnny Redman. If you vote for Johnny Redman, I will be your best friend and there will be no homework ever. Yeah! Tom's definitely looks the best. Countdown to school election. 1. We get to choose 3 kids to go to through to the final from our class. Then the whole school votes for who the school councillors will be. Who knows? I'm still wondering if Buster really took my drawing. When at break time, Derek comes running over to find me. He's shouting, Tom, 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 I've seen the drawing of you-know-who. He's got it. Buster has your drawing. Really? Are you sure? I say. Derek says it's definitely my drawing. While Buster was playing football, I took a peek in his bag and your drawing was there. I saw it. Why didn't you take it? I ask. I didn't think of that. Derek and I decided to go back and grab the drawing while Buster is still busy. This could be it. Finally. Norman wants to come too. He says he can jump around or just stand in everyone's way if he needs him to. That's Plan G. We creep towards Buster's bag while he's playing football. There are a few kids standing around and every time someone looks up we freeze. Standing around the bag trying not to look like we're up to anything dodgy isn't easy. Norman starts waving his arms around while I lean down towards it. I can see it, I tell Derek, who's keeping the lookout. I'm about to take my drawing when the football comes flying through the air right towards us. Norman leaps up and shouts, "Save!" Now everyone, including Buster, is looking over at us. "Gatesy, Gatesy, I want to talk to you." So much for Norman distracting attention away from us. I freeze until I realise that Buster is now running towards me. "Quick, let's go," Derek says. "Norman, throw me back the football, and we all leg it as fast as we can." Mr. Sprocket is standing by the school door ready to blow the whistle for an end of break, so we all run straight into school to get away from Buster. I'm out of breath and puffing. "That was close," I say to Derek before he goes to lesson. "At least you got your drawing back." "That was fun," Norman adds. "There's only one problem," I tell him. I didn't get my drawing. Plan H it is then. Plan H doesn't work. Get the drawing with a hook. Plan I, disguise, doesn't work. Over the next 2 days, I really tried to get my drawing back, but nothing works, and Buster still has it in his bag, which is not ideal. I'm not very happy about this at all. There's one bit of good news, though. The first round of voting for the school councillors has taken place, and me, Norman, and Julia Morton have made it through to the final. Yeah! Well done to everyone who took part. You three now need to write a speech for when the whole school goes to vote. Are you up for that? I forgot about that bit. Marcus didn't get three. You can tell just by looking at him. He perks up when Mr. Fullerman mentions eco-councillors. If anyone wants to put their names forward to be an eco-councillor, let me know. It's a very important part of school life. There's one person who does for sure. Smug little Marcus. The weekend visit to the cousins. We've had more postcards from the fossils, and they've sent some photos too. They look like they're having a lot of fun. There are loud noises coming from downstairs that wake me up really early in the morning. I feel a bit grumpy about this until I smell something that's a bit like pancakes. I get dressed and go downstairs as fast as I can and discover that it is pancakes, which cheers me up and an excellent start to the day after all. Delia must have smelt them cooking because she's up earlier than usual as well. Mum and Dad are very busy this morning. Isn't this nice? A lovely family breakfast. Together, Mum says, just before she burns one of the pancakes and sets the fire alarm off. Dad has to stand on a chair to push the button. Beep, beep, beep. He puts his hand onto the ceiling to steady himself and manages to knock over a cup of coffee with his foot. It spills all over the table and some of the pancakes too. I save my pancakes, but the others are a bit soggy. Dad looks for paper towels to clean up the mess. We've run out of paper towels and loads of other things too. I'll have to toast instead, Mum says before she realises there isn't any of that either. There's not much milk if you want cereal, Dad adds helpfully, just as Delia takes the last bit of chocolate spread to put on her pancake. So I call her a snake for not leaving me any for my pancake. Mum tells me, says, "That's enough for you two. Well, we'll do some shopping at some point. I don't know when." Then while Dad wipes up the coffee with a tea towel, I notice on the ceiling something that looks like a spider. So I say, "Spider!" Delia jumps and I laugh. Mum says, "Where?" "Up there," I point. "That's not a spider, that's my handprint from when I turned off the alarm. Sorry," Dad says. "Oh well, that's okay then. A grubby handprint on the ceiling." Mum doesn't sound very happy at all. "I'll clean it off when I have time," Dad tells her. "That will never happen then. So much for a nice family breakfast," Mum sighs. "Shouldn't you all be at Uncle Kevin's house by now?" Delia reminds everyone. "I'd forgotten about that." Mum rushes off to get ready and Dad tells me they'll drop me off first. "Have a nice time." "I know you will," Delia says as we leave the house. In the car, Mum and Dad are worried that Delia might be planning to have loads of her friends over while they're out. It's happened before, Mum says, as she puts on her makeup and... "Delia's a snake," I say from the back seat, because she took the last bit of chocolate spread. Mum gives me a look. "Enough of the snake, please," Mum sighs. Then she tells Dad to go the quick way. "I'm trying," he says, while stopping and starting all the time. It makes reading my comment tricky as well. "For goodness sake," Mum keeps muttering. When we finally get to Uncle Kevin's house, Mum jumps out the car and takes me to the house. I'm trying to tell her she's smudged her makeup when Uncle Kevin opens the door and does it for me. "Hello, whoa," with the What's with the wild makeup reader? In a hurry, will you? And wipes her eyes, which makes it worse. She tells, it's Frank's driving. The traffic was awful, she explains. Thanks so much for having Tom. We'll see you later. Now be good. I will, Uncle Kevin jokes. Mum runs back to the car and tries to fix her makeup and Dad drives off. Right, I've got a surprise for you, Tom. Which is a good start. Today's going to be okay after all. I like surprises, most of them. We got into the house and everyone seems pleased to see me, which is nice. Auntie Alice asks, how's that lovely sister of yours? Confused. Takes me a few seconds to work out who she's talking about. Do you mean Delia? She does, grumpy as always. Then Uncle Kevin says in a really loud, excited voice, it's great you're here, Tom, because now I can say, hands up if you want to come on a very special adventure. I put my hand up because I like the sound of adventure. Then I noticed the Kevin's hands hadn't moved at all. So I put mine down. Uncle Kevin says, that's sorted then. You're all coming, apart from me, Auntie Alice points out. And us, the cousins add. You're both going, Auntie Alice tells them. Don't you want to come? I ask the cousins, while Uncle Kevin goes off to get something. Trust us, Tom, bird watching isn't much of an adventure. Bird watching? I'm wondering if it's too late to change my mind when Uncle Kevin comes back and gives me a present. Here you go, Tom. Something for the special adventure. Thanks, Uncle Kevin, I say. I open the box. Binoculars. They used to be mine, but I thought you might like them. We can use them on the trip. The boys have their own already, don't you? We do, they sigh. They're brilliant, Uncle Kevin, I say, because I really do like them. Uncle Kevin tells me I'll be back in 5 minutes. Just got to get a few things together. While he's gone, the cousins tell me we have a surprise for you too, Tom. Stay here. We'll call you. I fall for it every time. Boo! You'd think I'd remember. After playing their trick again, the cousins tell me they have a few things to bring birdwatching as well. We have to hide them from Dad, though. They're waving around a couple of bird pictures cut out and stuck onto a card like puppets. I'm confused. What are they for? It's our emergency jaybird sighting, they explain. Dad won't go home until we've seen some kind of bird, so that's when we bring out these. See, like this. They demonstrate by shaking them around and making tweeting noises. That actually works, I wonder, because it's not that convincing. Trust us, it works, they say, hiding the birds as Uncle Kevin comes back. He's wearing a very odd jacket. This one's yours, Tom. I'll help you blend in with foliage so you don't stand out too much. You can say that again. We'll head to the one near that small river. There's plenty of wildlife to look at. Auntie Alice suggests, we have lunch before we go, which sounds like a good idea to me. But then she adds, it's tuna casserole. Is that okay with you, Tom? My face gives away how I'm feeling. Luckily, Uncle Kevin wants to save time, so we bring sandwiches with us. I'm very happy about that. The special adventure, bird watching, sort of. When Dad's not around, Uncle Kevin likes to tell me stories about when we were both kids. He's always been clumsy. He used to have hair. Today he's telling me the binocular story. Dad told me this story before, so I say Dad said he put boot polish on the eyepieces to stop you from pinching them. I just borrowed them, Uncle Kevin explains. Dad said the marks around your eyes lasted a month. He laughed a lot when he told me that. The cousins are laughing now too. They lasted a week. Typical of your dad to exaggerate. Dad said you look like a panda. I'm laughing now too. Shh, you lot, you'll scare away the birds. I get the feeling that Uncle Kevin doesn't want to talk about the binoculars anymore. We start doing a bit of bird watching and my new binoculars are brilliant. Close-up sparrow. Uncle Kevin tells me a few interesting bird watching facts as we walk. Some are more interesting than others. Thanks to the big book of bird watching, I know quite a lot about birds already. We're still waiting when Uncle Kevin says, shh, look over there. We pick up our binoculars and I can see nothing at all. So we wait. Then we wait a bit more. And a bit more on top of that. Bird watching is all about patience, Uncle Kevin is telling us, and being really bored. The cousins whisper to me. Keep nice and still. I think there's a jay over there. Uncle Kevin tells us, but all I can hear now is stomach rumbling. The rumbling gets so loud, Uncle Kevin says we should eat lunch now, which is a great idea until I see what it is. Tuna sandwich, Tom, he says. The cousins are happy to eat mine while I eat everything else on offer. The great thing about bird watching is that some days you might not see a lot of birds, but in the excitement of what's out there. So let's keep looking, Uncle Kevin keeps a bird watching notebook so he can write down what he sees. How long do we have to stay here for? The cousins asks. As long as it takes, Uncle Kevin tells us. The cousins give me a look. Operation Fate Bird goes into action. I keep Uncle Kevin chatting while they disappear and place the birds just far enough that they look real. Look, Uncle Kevin. Over there, I tell him. He's so happy we finally got to see such beautiful birds. Wasn't that fascinating? It was, I say, as the cousins sneak back and agree with everything he says. Amazing. We stay for a while longer and Uncle Kevin keeps looking. Next time we come bird watching, we should get up really early to catch the best birds, I'm thinking, next time. Eventually, Uncle Kevin says we can go home. What a shame we didn't see more birds, but there's just not many around today. Mum and Dad are late picking me up from the cousins, so I have to stay for dinner too. The tuna casserole is finished, which is a relief. Tuna, cross. So we have noodles and listen to Uncle Kevin talking about the jaybird sighting and how amazing they were. Auntie Alice wonders why me and the cousins were all laughing. No reason, we all say. When Mum and Dad arrive, Uncle Kevin tells them about the jaybird sighting too. It's hard to keep a straight face. I say thank you for having me instead, which helps. In the car driving home, Mum asks me if I had a good time. It was a lot more fun than I thought it was going to be, which is true. When we get back home, something unbelievable has happened, something that's never happened before. Mum and Dad are stunned. I'm surprised too. Delia has only gone and made dinner. It's just pizza, but she's never done it before. She's even laid the table and made salad too. Mum and Dad won't stop going on about Delia making them dinner. I've eaten already, so it's a good time to go to bed. When Delia comes home, late, from her friend's house, she wakes me up by slamming the door. Normally she'd get in trouble for it, being late, being noisy. But because she made dinner, Mum and Dad don't say a word. In the morning, they're still in shock about dinner and how amazing it was. It was just pizza, I point out, when they say how nice it was again. I must remember that. Making dinner equals happy parents. They didn't even ask why she was late home, which is a big shame because I quite like hearing those excuses. Here are some of the best. Delia's top 5 late excuses. Number 1, I just forgot. Number 2, I didn't hear what time you said. Number 3, really, I'm late. Number 4, the bus, car, taxi, train was late. Number 5, it's your fault for being so strict. Mum and Dad keep telling her how wonderful it was to come home to dinner. I think they're going over the top a little bit because it was only a bought pizza after all. But since they seem to be in such a good mood, I try asking if I can go over to Derek's house later today. I really want to show him the binoculars Uncle Kevin gave me. Mum says I can go to Derek's next weekend once your test is out of the way. Is that okay? Not really, I tell her. And Dad says, what binoculars? The ones Uncle Kevin gave me. He gave you binoculars. Can I see them? I go out and get them to show Dad. They're mine. I knew Kevin took my binoculars. In case Dad gets any ideas about taking them back, I remind Uncle Kevin gave them to me, so now they're mine. Dad looks at them and starts to say, have I ever told you about the time when I put boot polish on the ends of... Mum stops him by holding up two hands. Yes, Frank, we've all heard that story before. Dad gets the message and puts the binoculars down. Look after them, won't you, Tom? He sighs. I promise, I say, just before I trip up. Countdown to election. Zero this week. It's all happening this week at school. The test, the school council election, and parents' evening. Something I'd forgotten about. The fossils are coming home as well. They sent us another postcard that has made us all think Granny Mavis might be keen to try out a few nice dishes on us at some point. Insect nibbles. Special insects rolled in seeds and deep fried. Yum. I've managed not to think about how Buster still has my drawing. I just hope he doesn't leave it somewhere or do something silly with it. When I go into class, it's all a bit more relaxed for the test this time. Mr. Fullerman is even playing music as we come into class, which is quite nice. We sit down and are ready to turn over the paper and start your test. So that's what we do. The whole test goes surprisingly well. Not itchy foot this time. When it's over, Mr. Fullerman tells us we'll find out how we did at parents' evening. Like that's something to look forward to. Nothing to worry about at all, he adds. Plan A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y. I've lost track. Plan Z. Me, Derek, Norman, Solid and Brad are all hanging out together in the school ground after the test. I'm glad that's over, Norman says. Me too, I agree. Then Derek asks me if I've worked out my speech for the school election. Speech? What speech? Something else I'd forgotten about. I've done mine, Norman says. Then he stands on the bench and gives me a demonstration of his carefully thought out speech. What do we want? Then here's you have to shout back at me, chips. So we all shout, chips. When do we want them? Now. That's my speech, really. I read out a list and do lots of jumping and shouting. I still better than my speech, that's for sure. I stand on the bench and have a think about what to say. Up here, I can see right over to the other side of the school grounds to where kids are playing football. And that's when I spot Buster Jones, who suddenly looked right back at me. Or does he? I'm quite far away, so I stay still and keep looking at him to see what he's going to do. Go back to playing football, turn around, or start running towards me. Uh-oh, I shout, quick, I have to hide. Buster's coming over. Tell him I've gone somewhere else. Don't mention my drawing. I look around, and there's just enough time to hide behind a plant pot. Buster's comes over and asks everyone, where's Gatesy? Never heard of him, Norman says, which is a silly thing to say, because of course he knows who I am. Buster knows that too. Oh, Tom's gone back to class. He was in a hurry, Derek says. Well, tell him I really need to see him. It's important. Okay, Pingle? Derek nods as Buster starts to walk away. Phew, that's close. It's never a good thing if Buster wants to talk to you. I'm waiting for the coast to be clear when Marcus Meldrew taps me on the shoulder. What are you doing hiding there? Tom, go away, Marcus, please. Why are you hiding, Tom? He won't go, so I decide to make a run for it. Just as Buster hears my name, I'm off. Buster spots me and now he's shouting, Gatesy, Gatesy. I don't know what he wants and I'm not going to hang around to find out. I manage to run back to class just as the bell goes. I'm not out of breath, but at least Buster can't bother me here. Amy Porter sits down and says, you look red and a bit puffed out, Tom. Yup, I say, because I can't talk properly yet. If you get the feeling Buster is going to keep looking for me, I might have to do a lot more hiding and running, or both, to keep out of his way. I manage to avoid Buster Jones for the rest of the day, but it's the rest of the week that gets a bit tricky. It's like we're playing hide and seek, but all the time. Me hiding in the trees, hiding in cloakroom, under table. Phew. I'm starting to get a bit fed up trying to avoid Buster. Derek tells me I should find out what he wants. You can't keep running off and hiding. Tom, it's crazy. Derek's right. I've had enough. I decide I'm going to go up to Buster once and for all and ask for my drawing back. Then I'll find out what he wants. No more hiding for me. I'm going to find him right after school election speeches. I'll do it then. Countdown to school election now. School council speeches. After I saw Norman Chip's speech, I thought I should practice what I'm going to say. I did at home, which was fine, until Delia heard me and started putting me off. Ha ha ha, what are you doing? Derek came round and he told me I was going to do fine, so I ignored Delia. Right now, I'm trying to ignore Marcus Meldrew, who wants to know if I'm nervous about making a speech in front of the whole entire school. I wasn't until you reminded me, Marcus, I say. We all go into the hall, and yes, the whole school is there. Mr. Keane gives us another talk about defacing school property. He says there's been no more graffiti, and he hopes it's going to stay that way. Caretaker Stan is nodding his head. I make sure I don't look at him for too long. The idea of much shorter school days gets a big cheer for the first speaker. Next, Julia Morton tells everyone they should vote for her because she is very organised. True. You can talk to teachers. True. Kids like her. True. She'll bring in cake on Friday. Wow. She gets my vote and a big round of applause. There are a few more kids from different classes that make speeches before Norman does a great job with his chip speech. Now it's my turn. I've got a copy of my poster to read from. Hello everyone. I'd like to be your school counsellor for lots of reasons. For a start, Monday will no longer be the day that everyone dreads. Monday will be fun day. When I spot Buster Jones looking straight at me, he says, I have your drawing. I stop talking and start saying, I'm going to make, So where was I? I managed to finish my speech, but Buster really puts me off. It wasn't great. This is getting stupid. When I get back to class, Marcus says, what happened to you? And I say, nothing. I just have to go and sort something out, and that's what I do. At lunchtime, Derek comes with me because he wants me to sort this out too. You'll be fine, Tom. I'm here. I can see Buster chatting to some kids. I walk over, go up and say, Buster Jones. Before I can change my mind, he turns around. Gatesy, I've been looking for you. Me too. My voice goes all small. Did you leave a drawing inside a book? Yes. Then Buster says, it's the funniest drawing I've ever seen in my whole life. Hilarious. I couldn't stop laughing when I saw it in the library. You're lucky I found it and not one of the teachers. I took it to keep it safe for you, Tom. Here, don't lose it. Hmm? I was expecting Buster to say that. I wasn't expecting Buster to say that. Huh? Derek's shocked too. I saw you hide something in that bird-watching book in the library. I guess you were looking for it, so I wanted to help you get it back. You don't want to end up in trouble like me. And thanks for not saying anything about my little drawing. Then Buster hands me back my drawing. Hang on. One more look, he says, and starts laughing again. Derek gets to see it too. It was worth the wait. He laughs too. We still can't believe Buster was actually nice and helpful. Who knew? Parents' Evening grown. Top 5 reasons why Parents' Evening can be tricky. Parents' dodgy outfits. 2. Parents talking about me. 3. Parents talking about me. 4. Teachers telling parents things you don't want them to know. 5. Parents telling teachers things you don't want them to know. I have to ask Dad to lose the sunglasses before we go into Parents' Evening. Mum agrees with me. Ridiculous. Mr. Fullerman smiles and greets us, saying, lovely to see you both, and you too, Tom. I'm not sure that's really us. They have a general chat about me while I keep quiet, but then my school planner gets a mention. Uh-oh, I'm guessing you didn't write these comments about Tom, Mr. and Mrs. Gates. Interesting, I've been rumbled. Whoops. The next thing that comes up is my school test result. Remarkable improvement, Tom. Well done. Almost 100% better than before. It was all down to not having an itchy foot, sir, I say, which makes everyone look confused. And the extra study I did, I add. Parents' Evening goes okay. Well done, Tom, Mum and Dad are very pleased with me, despite my extra school planner comments. I only wrote them because you were so busy. I thought I was helping, I tell Mum and Dad, which is sort of true. We're walking up the school past the glass cabinet with all the teachers' photos in. Buster's handiwork has all gone now. Oh, that's what I thought. Mum says, gosh, since when has Mr. Keane had a moustache like that? Uh-oh, Buster's been at it again. Mrs. Knapp doesn't look too good either. Sleepover and band practice at Derek's house. At last, here are my top 5 reasons to have a sleepover. Number 1, excellent snacks. Number 2, chance to write brilliant new songs. 3, having a really good laugh with my friends. 4, Delia is out of the way. 5, staying awake, really awake, not sleepy. I've been waiting ages for this sleepover. Derek has everything planned out and we're doing band practice first. We all have ideas for new songs that we talk about first, in between snacks. Writing songs isn't easy, is it? Derek says. We could do another cover song if we can think of a good one. Norman jumps up and says, hey, I almost forgot I brought my new instrument and I wrote a new song to play you. Do you want to hear it? Of course I do. Why don't you tell us earlier? Norman goes downstairs and gets the new instrument Derek and I wonder what it is. More drums, bass guitar, ukulele. Oh, great. Norman tells us, my song's a bit like my school council election speech, which sounds interesting. He's about to start playing for us when in comes Derek's dad, Mr. Fingal. Hi, boys. I have some very exciting news. Can you guess what it is? Is it about an old band by any chance, Dad? Derek asks him, how did you guess? It's very exciting, Derek says. What is it then? Our next door neighbour, who is in plastic cup, told me they were reuniting. Isn't that amazing? Not really. Derek isn't impressed. Dad, we're in the middle of band practice. Norman's written a new song. He's going to play it for us now, I tell him. Well done, Norman. Mind if I stay and listen? Just don't say anything, will you? I'm ready when you are, Norman tells us, and he gets ready to play. It's called The School Dinner Blows, and it goes like this.